Hello everyone, I am Zach Peterson. Welcome back to the DENPAFLUX channel. Today, I'm going to be showing all of you five common problems in a PCB layout that can create havoc for EMI and EMC. Now, we're not just going to talk about these PCB layout problems, we're also going to look at some examples, and we're going to look at some test data that shows the right way to do things in your PCB layout. Let's go ahead and get started. Let's look at PCB layout problem number one, splitting a ground plane into analog and digital sections. I can't tell you how many times I've seen AI-generated PCB design content on LinkedIn, and they constantly include this as a good design practice. This may have been a good design practice back in the 1980s when I was still a child, and when digital signal edge rates were slower, and analog signals ran at lower frequencies, but today it just doesn't fly. The reason it doesn't work today is because those analog and digital ground sections turn into nice big radiating dipole antennas. That dipole antenna you form from the analog and digital ground sections can then radiate into free space, and that causes you to fail a radiated emissions test. You should only be splitting grounds up into two different disconnected sections when you have specific applications like a requirement for galvanic isolations, as well as some very specific applications in precision signal measurement with low signal-to-noise ratio. And even in these applications, you typically still need to link those two ground sections back together, most often with a Y-type capacitor or another class of safety capacitor. I can't tell you how many designs I've seen where somebody will use a ferrite bead to reconnect the analog and digital sections of a PCB, and that's only going to make your emissions problem even worse. The best practice is to use a single ground plane and place your analog circuitry away from your digital circuitry so that they don't have a chance to interfere with each other. PCB layout problem number two, insufficient ground, or in some cases, no ground at all, especially in two-layer designs. Now, as I've reviewed more two-layer designs, and as I've gotten more questions about two-layer PCB design, I've noticed that many new designers will try to always confine their PCB layouts to two layers. This is a problem when you have a lot of signals, because if you're using ground pour to try and provide ground, eventually a lot of your signals won't have any ground at all. That means if those traces are carrying any fast digital signals, those signals will radiate strongly into free space, and once again you have a radiated emissions problem. Take a look at this example on screen. Here we have a PCB layout with pretty dense signal routing on two layers. In this layout, the designer attempted to apply ground to all of the signals on both layers using coplanar ground pour. That's fine for some of the signals near the edge of some of these routes, but in the center, you can see that many of these traces don't have any nearby ground. If these traces are just carrying DC, it's fine because those signals don't have any switching action. But if any of these traces are carrying a fast digital signal, like part of an SPI bus, fast GPIOs, or a PWM signal, they can radiate strongly into free space. Once again, that creates a radiated emissions problem, and the solution to this problem is very simple. Just start your design on a four-layer PCB stackup. PCB layout problem number three, clearing ground below the switching node in a switching regulator circuit. Many PCB designs, even those operating at low power, will often use a switching regulator to provide very efficient step up or step down in the output voltage. The power that comes into a switch node on a regulator circuit can switch very quickly, and that fast switching can cause radiated emissions from the switch node. Removing ground below the switching node doesn't just impact radiated emissions, it also impacts conducted emissions, and this is something that has been studied by many industry experts. Now, once again, back in the 1980s, when switching frequencies were lower and edge rates were lower, this didn't really matter so much, and it was appropriate to remove a ground cutout below the switching node and below components like power inductors. But in today's modern designs, there is a huge amount of test data that shows that this is no longer a good practice. Let's take a look at some of this test data. First, let's take a look at this article by Ken Wyatt and Steve Sandler in Signal Integrity Journal. In this article, Ken Wyatt and Steve Sandler look at the effect of adding a solid return plane or placing cutouts under the switching node and inductor in a switching regulator. Test data is very clear. Above 10 megahertz, there is a noticeable reduction in radiated emissions when the ground cutout is removed from the PCB layout. Below 10 megahertz, the performance of the two circuits with the cutout and without the cutout are very similar. These results from Ken Wyatt and Steve Sandler nicely validate that keeping a solid ground beneath the switching node in a switching regulator circuit is the best choice from an EMC perspective. Wyatt and Sandler aren't the only people to investigate the use of cutouts below DC-DC converter circuits. Take a look at this test data from Monolithic Power Systems. Here you can see this test data shows conducted emissions testing failure by about 50 dB. That is a big failure in the EMC world. In this test PCB, a ground cutout was used below the switching node, and they omitted using a filter on the output of this circuit. Now take a look at what happens when they use solid ground below the switching regulator circuit, and they add a filter on the output. This test data shows that by using solid ground and adding a two-stage filter on the output of the regulator circuit, the conducted emissions are below the required limits given in CISPR, and they're below the OEM limit. Make sure to check out the links in the description to get access to these studies. Now for PCB layout challenge number four, forgetting to apply a stitching via near a signal via. When you have a board with four or more layers and you're routing between layers, you need to make sure that you maintain a consistent return path across those layers. The easiest way to do this is to place a stitching via that connects to the ground planes near your signal via that makes the signal transition across the stack up. We can see an example here on screen. In this example, we have a trace that's part of an SPI bus, and it does have fast switching rate. We can make sure that the return path on this signal is maintained in the process of transiting the stack up by placing this nearby stitching via. Now, most designers will rely on an automated stitching via tool to apply those stitching vias and connect the grounds throughout the stack up. The problem with automated via stitching tools is that they place vias in a regular array. They won't place a stitching via next to a signal that's also crossing the stack up. What you need to do as a designer is intentionally place one of those stitching vias near your signal via to ensure that you maintain that return path across the stack up. Don't rely on the stitching via tool to do it for you automatically. And PCB layout challenge number five, accidentally placing antenna regions in your copper pour. Not every PCB layout needs grounded copper pour on every layer, but there are times where you should use it. For example, to balance copper throughout the stack up and prevent warpage, or to provide coplanar ground for targeted nets. The problem with an automated copper pour tool is that they can sometimes create antenna regions by filling in the empty spaces between traces in your layout. Take a look at this example on screen. Here you can see that the dense trace routing prevents the copper pour tool from filling in the space between these traces with copper pour. This is due to the clearance requirements around these traces. Nearby, we can see that there is a region where the copper pour has filled in the space between two traces, but it basically ends and looks like an antenna. These regions can contribute to emissions if they remain disconnected from the main ground region or if they have high return path impedance back to the main system ground. An easy way to solve this is to space out those traces so that the copper pour can fill in the region between them, or to apply a stitching via right there in the antenna region to connect back to the main system ground. This is a task you'll need to perform during a PCB layout review after you've finished your routing. Larger regions of copper pour that look like antennas will resonate at lower frequencies, so make sure to deal with the largest regions first. If you want a solution that helps you identify these PCB layout problems and many more, make sure to check out DENPAFLUX. DENPAFLUX scans through your specification and your PCB layout file, identifies potential EMI problems, and generates a report that gives you recommended solutions to these problems. Don't wait until your board fails EMC testing. Contact DENPAFLUX first to help ensure EMC compliance. Thanks for watching this video, everybody. Make sure to hit the like button, hit the subscribe button, and we'll be making many more videos about all the topics I've discussed in this video. We'll see you next time.